Good afternoon. I'm Mike Ball, Senior Manager for FAA Initiatives for Northrop Grumman's Civil Division. I'd like to welcome you to today's NextGen Workforce for Aviation live stream. As a partner in delivering NextGen, we are honored today to bring this important conversation to the aviation industry, an industry that requires the best people, systems, and strategies to provide the safest and most efficient aerospace system in the world. We'd like to thank you for tuning in today and thank our experts for participating. We look forward to a great discussion on the NextGen aviation workforce. And with that, I will turn it over to our moderator, Carol Hedden, Executive Editorial Director for Aviation Week and Space Technologies, Workforce and Program Excellence Programs. Carol.
Thanks, Mike. Many meetings have taken place, and in our case, a lot of copy written, about the technologies that are involved in NextGen. Much less has been written or talked about with regard to the foundation of the program, the people. And that's why we're here today, to talk about the people who are bringing NextGen into reality and who we desperately need to propel it into the future in a way that stays apace with technological development. Our panel today includes Pamela Whitley, the FAA's Deputy Assistant Administrator for NextGen, the organization tasked with developing and executing the myriad programs involved with keeping this infrastructure on track as it continuously evolves. Also with us is Peter Dumont, the Air Traffic Control Association's President and CEO, and one of NextGen's primary voices in outreach to students. ATCA's Young Aviation Professionals Group was created to unite aviation's incoming professionals. Also with us is Alex Nakahara, a systems engineer and future technical leader for Northrop Grumman, whose education and career have been focused on NextGen, and who has also served on the advisory board for Aviation Week's Workforce Studies. We'll kick off the program now, and then we'll take your questions. So please join our conversation using NextGen Workforce. That's hashtag NextGen Workforce. Now let's get started. Pamela, I think it would be good to get a general sense of what is involved exactly with NextGen, where we are today in terms of the execution, and what you see as the primary challenges as we move forward the next couple of years.
Thank you, Carol. I'll be happy to share that. With NextGen, we've made a lot of progress, and we've been focusing over the last 5 or 6 years on getting a solid plan and building programs that we could execute and then ultimately delivering benefits to the user. And we've made great progress there in terms of establishing our foundational programs. The core elements of aviation are COM, NAV, surveillance, and automation. So our programs are structured to modernize those platforms for us. In our automation domain, we have completed the installation of ERAM, which is the replacement of our host computer, and that system is now deployed and functional in all of our centers. We're making progress on our terminal automation platform, which is being deployed as we speak in the larger metropolitan areas in the terminal environment. And much of that will be completed in 16. In terms of our surveillance platform, we have integrated into our system a GPS infrastructure that allows us to get better position information on aircraft, and we call that ADS-B. It is also active today, providing a broadcast of positioning information, and we're in the research phase of getting information into the cockpit. So we call that piece of it ADS-BN. We've also spent a lot of money working on moving aviation to the digital age. We have a platform that we call SWIM, and it is all about getting aviation information into a more open domain, and it will allow us to get information in the right place at the right time to make decisions. So we've been able to make great progress. We still have a lot to do. Part of our progress is, you know, because we have been working collaboratively with the community. We have a group called the NextGen Advisory Committee, which represents all of the elements of industry that have a interest in aviation. In that committee, we've developed a set of priorities, and those priorities have helped us focus on the things that provide the most benefit to the user. And we've been able to make progress on data communications through that environment, also implementing the new procedures that support performance-based navigation. And our wake recategorization work was a very scientific thing that we've been able to complete and provide some benefits in different areas. So those things together have put us on a path to provide immediate benefit, have a set of platforms that we will be able to build on for a long time to come.
Great. Thank you, Pamela. I want to turn to Pete now, because obviously this is going to require some serious changes in terms of the air traffic control community. If you could kind of talk to us a little bit about those changes and how you and the air traffic controllers will be moving forward with them.
Well, it will require some changes, but the air traffic control system over the years has been constantly changing. And the important thing is training, to ensure that we train the controllers and the people that maintain the equipment to ensure that they're up to the challenge of the new technologies that Pam just spoke of. I think wake recap, which Pam was just speaking about, is a great example. It was developed, it was scientifically put together, and then it was introduced to the workforce. The workforce is slowly but surely training on it, and it's becoming, as it's being implemented, it's very much helping reduce the separation of aircraft as well as increase the throughput at airports. The difference, I think, now is with a new entering workforce, I think training is going to change. So we have, and it's going to be a challenge for the FAA because we've done it, the FAA has done it that way, the same way, for a long period of time. Three different ways. Book training, classroom training, then on-the-job training, which is someone standing over your shoulder showing you how to do the work, and then simulation at most facilities. Millennials, so born between 81 and 99, learn a little differently than we do. We have an intergenerational workforce now. So you've got the millennials that were born into technology, and you have their predecessors like me that had to learn technology. I wasn't born into it. I think that's going to present some problems we haven't seen, or some challenges that we haven't seen before, as we try to train new controllers. My observations have been that they get easily bored. You know, you have to keep them challenged, and that, I think, is going to be one of our biggest challenges.
Great. Thanks, Pete.
Sure.
I wanted to go back to you, Pamela, because one of the things that is interesting is to look at just who is doing this work. And we're going to come back and talk about technologies in a minute, but could you give us an overview of who an FAA employee is? I mean, what's the average age? What's some information about the workforce that is implementing NextGen?
So, Carol, thank you for asking that question. Right now, if you look at the FAA as a whole, our workforce is, you know, kind of senior in nature. The average age is about 48. The number of years of experience is over 22 years of experience. And right now, we would say less than 15% of our workforce is under the age of 35. So we see that, we definitely recognize it. The administrator has made workforce of the future one of his primary goals, and it is one of our top four priorities with his leadership. So we're focusing on, you know, how do we address that knowledge transfer? How do we get the right workforce on board? How do we provide those opportunities to them? And I'd like to just kind of piggyback off of Pete's comments, you know, the millennials will come into the workplace with different expectations. But we also see that as an opportunity because they will bring technology with them, or the understanding of technology with them, and really be able to help us exploit some of the things that we already have going. And what do I mean by that? So today we're building an environment that will allow us to turn data into information. We're rich with aviation data. The power of data is information that supports decision making. So we're excited about the new workforce coming into the workplace and really bringing their understanding of technology and helping us apply it to this industry.
That's great. One of the things that Alex and I found when we were working on the workforce study is that the aerospace and defense industry overall, the average age is 47, so not just the FAA, the entire industry, and about 21% of that workforce is under the age of 30. And so as people are retiring and moving along, we are hiring more people in, and that's good news. Pete, from your vantage point, what about the ATC community? Pete, can you take your mute button off, please?
All right, sorry about that. Right, as you probably saw from your workforce study, the air traffic control force is a bit aging and approaching a retirement bubble where we're going to lose a lot of the inherent knowledge that's there in air traffic control and a lot of the experience as we hire on new, younger air traffic controllers. So like Pam was talking about with knowledge transfer, we have to manage that knowledge transfer very carefully to ensure that we don't have any degradation in our services or in the way we deliver the service to the end users.
One of the things that we found in the Aviation Week study, and this doesn't matter if it was in the 1990s or it's this year, the number one reason people are attracted to this industry is the technological challenge. And so I'd like to look at it for just a moment about what you see as the future challenges. This is when you go into a classroom at the middle school level or even the elementary school level, we tend to show pictures of spaceships and that type of thing. But NextGen is very exciting as well. What are some of the cool technology that is being integrated into NextGen and that you think will play a part in the future? So, Pamela, if you could look at that a little bit.
So when we talk about cool technology, I think, you know, ADS-B changes the game, per se. You know, having the ability to have exact aircraft information and being able to use that information to create a display for the controller and maybe one day the pilot, so that the pilot will be able to see things around him that he can't see today. Very exciting. When you take that and you add that to onboard avionics and having the ability for the onboard avionics on one airplane to actually use information from another airplane to maintain safe distances, it will allow us to use pavement today that we can't use when sometimes we have runways that are very closely spaced together. When it comes to data and information, you know, one of the things we point to as a primary reason for delays in the system is weather. Weather information, there's so much, I've learned so much about weather, you know, in this job because weather information is critical. But weather information about where an airplane will be at a point in time makes this a very different environment. It allows us to do decision making in a way that we couldn't do before. So if I know that a plane is going to interact weather, I can make adjustments in his flight planning and make those adjustments early enough so that everything impacted by that has the same data and that you can minimize the impact that it has on efficiency in the system. So there are many things that we'll be able to do. The work that we've done to date has been all about getting this system into a digital environment so that data is usable in different places for different decision making.
Great. I think it'd be interesting to hear from Alex as well, because obviously he made this choice. Not only did he make this choice as an employment opportunity, but Alex also studied this at MIT as a graduate student. So, Alex, if you could kind of walk us through, what were the things that convinced you that this was one of the problems that faced our society that you wanted to devote yourself to?
Sure. So, I guess I'll start in grad school. When I was going into getting my master's, I wasn't really sure what I wanted to do. And the thing that I was pretty sure about was that I wanted to do something where my work just wouldn't sit on a shelf and it would make sort of a tangible difference. So I hadn't actually known much about air traffic control. There was an offer as a position to go do it. And it really appealed to me versus doing something like one of my friends studied, how they could change the shape of a future blade in a jet engine that would be implemented 20 years in the future. That just seemed too far out. I got to look at studying the potential benefits of an FAA program that should hopefully begin this year and be implemented at airports around the country. So having the chance to really make a difference in a tangible way and in an important way for the country, I think, is one of the huge differentiators that the industry has in attracting young talent. And I think that that's also one of the main drivers for millennials or the next generation, whatever you want to call it, is that opportunity to make a difference. People want to know that their work has meaning, that they solve hard problems, not just for the sake of solving problems, but because that has a purpose.
Now, as you were looking at it in terms of your career now, I mean, there are a lot of options that are out there. What do you think are the things that have made your career thus far rewarding, and what are you kind of looking forward to in the future?
I would say that really getting to dive into a problem and understand the sort of all the aspects of why it hasn't been solved yet. I think it's easy to sort of be on the outside and say, why haven't they solved this yet? This seems really easy. And you really need to understand all the aspects of the problem, whether it's the workforce, the controllers using the tools, the data being supplied to the tools themselves. There are so many different parts to a problem that when you really understand a problem and then you can develop a solution that actually works, that's really rewarding. So going into the future, I just hope that I can continue to help solve real problems.
Pamela, I wanted to turn to you because one of the things that I've heard frequently is even if I am totally committed to wanting to be part of the FAA and NextGen, it's tough to get a job these days. There's a lot of hoops to have to go through. What is your advice to a young person wanting to become part of the NextGen team, part of your team?
So the first thing I would say is, you know, working on NextGen doesn't mean that you always have to work for the FAA. I mean, the community is large, and we have many companies that are participating in research activities, prototyping new technology, and then ultimately building that technology. So working with NextGen, you know, doesn't mean that you have to work for the FAA. So I'll talk a little bit about kind of working for the government first. There's a process that the government has in terms of applying for positions. All of our positions are publicly posted on usajobs.gov, and there's criteria there on, you know, what positions you qualify for. We do have in our office relationships with several universities through our Centers of Excellence. We have Centers of Excellence that actually do research on behalf of the FAA, and in a lot of cases, those are graduate students. So we've built relationships with those universities, and we often have opportunities for those students to actually come and work for the FAA. Within the NextGen office, we participate in what's called the Pathways Program, and that program is an internship program for college students. Once they have completed the program, there's always an option for us to bring them on board permanently, and we have done so. So within the government process, There's a standard process by which you apply for jobs for students. There's several programs where they can interact with us before they retire, which will give them an opportunity to learn more about what we do and compete for jobs in the future. For the larger community, there are many companies that are working with us here in headquarters, doing research activities. We have multiple contract vehicles that they're on. And those individuals are as important to us as the government employees. So I would just encourage people to understand the opportunities that are there. Of course, I think the FAA is a great place to work, so I would put that first. But there are other opportunities with other companies that would make you a great contributor as well.
Great. If anybody has additional questions, I'm going to keep asking questions. But if any of our visitors to the Hangout have questions, remember to go to hashtag NextGenWorkforce, and we'll work those into this conversation as well. Pete, I wanted to go back to you. As they frequently say, I never really thought about being an air traffic controller. What if I'm a young person or any person, I believe, interested in an ATC job? What are the things I need to be doing to prepare myself to enter that workforce?
Well, there are a couple of pathways to getting to becoming an air traffic controller. An air traffic controller isn't just air traffic controllers. It's made up of engineers. It's made of support people. It's made of software engineers. It's made up of a lot of different people. There are a lot of different avenues and a lot of different pieces to air traffic control other than just being an air traffic controller, which we try to get across to the younger generation, our young aviation professionals, or YAPs as we call them. Well, first you have to get them interested in it. So, you know, we need to be talking about this in schools. I go to schools and I talk about aviation, aerospace, air traffic control. I was at the Wright Memorial Dinner on Friday night, and Bert Rutan, did you go?
I was there.
Yeah,
okay, so Bert Rutan was the awardee, and they put a video up about how he got interested in airplanes, and it was fascinating. I think it should be shown to every school that has a STEM program, every school that has anyone that might be just a little bit interested in aviation. Personally, I visited a control tower when I was 11 years old and decided I wanted to be an air traffic controller. And as I said, there are different pathways. The pathway I took as I entered the military, became a Navy air traffic controller, and later contract air traffic controller, did some work for the FAA. You can go to a CTI school and get an air traffic control degree, or you can actually, now you can be hired with just general work experience once you pass a certain test to become an air traffic controller. It's a great job. It was absolutely a great job for me because I'm an instant gratification guy, and it's that kind of a job. You know as soon as you take your headset off whether you had a good day or a bad day. And that's one of the things, and it's never the same. It's always something different. So that's what I liked about it, and I think that's what's appealing about it.
Great. Now, Alex, clearly you went the route of working for one of the contractors that Pamela discussed. What would you say are the things people should watch for in trying to secure a job with an organization like Northrop Grumman?
So apart from the technical skills, which to some degree you just need to have, I think there's two more intangible skills that are really important, both to getting a job and then to succeeding in the job once you're in it. And those would be adaptability and communicating well. So by adaptability, I mean that today's technology is changing so rapidly that just knowing one specific programming language or software package isn't going to be enough. You have to know how to learn. You have to be able to take a new thing and adapt to it and succeed in it relatively quickly. That helps more on the job. You're able to sort of volunteer for things with more confidence. Once you succeed in one or two things, your boss knows that you're able to learn new things, and he feels more free in giving you more opportunities. It sort of has a snowball effect. I think in the 3 or so years I've been here, I've had 6 or 7 or more distinct different roles where a lot of the time I had almost no knowledge of the specific area I was going into, but I was able to sort of pick them up relatively quickly. For communicating well, I think that for people with the same technical background and skills, there's still a wide variance in how they perform and the impact that they make on an organization, and that's a lot due to how well you can communicate. So that's both communicating technically to your peers and also communicating something to a non-technical person, such as management or a customer. Being able to get your ideas across really makes an important impact on how well they're received, how well they're implemented. Communicating your own persona in an interview is really important. You can have different people who one doesn't say anything and one's willing to talk a lot, and that'll determine who gets the job. So I think doing both of those well will help you succeed both in getting a job and succeeding once you're in the job.
Great. Now, I wanted to ask you, how did you get interested in working in this field?
That's a very good question. So I'm an engineer by training, and I started out as an electrical engineer. My first job in the FAA was in the Office of Airports, and I basically worked on systems that are owned and operated by the airport, and then eventually moved into the air traffic side. So I grew up in Louisiana, came to Washington, and when you come to Washington, the first thing they tell you you should do is to find a government job. And I applied for several government jobs, and the FAA was the first place that I was hired. And it's been a great career for me. I will tell you, one of the first things I learned on the job is I worked on a project, and Pete, you may remember this, it was called Land and Hold Short Operation.
Right, yes.
Which is very, very important from a safety standpoint to use a portion of the runway during landing. And in that project, I had an opportunity to work with air traffic controllers, other engineers, airport representatives, airline representatives, even an insurance expert. And very early in my career, I learned that my job as an engineer was to support air traffic control and safe movement of airplanes. So having that, you know, as a foundation of kind of my training up front made me see engineering as an enabler for the great things that we do in terms of moving passengers every day. So getting interested just was happen chance. Growing to love it is just what happens when you walk through the door.
Now, if you don't mind me asking, and I'm going to kind of walk through this with you and Alex, but what prompted you to go into engineering?
What prompted me to go into engineering? Hope my mother's not listening to this, but my mother taught English and history, so I wanted to do the other stuff. and I was naturally good at math and science. I mean, it was something that, you know, if I didn't study for the test, I was assured I would get a B plus or an A. So it just became very natural to me. Early on in my life, I was, introduced to engineering by a family friend who was an electrical engineer. And I just kind of had a great interest in understanding how things work. I took apart all kinds of things in the house, typewriters and different things, and it just became very natural to me to be in that space. And once I got into it, just had a lot of good opportunities, and coming to the FAA and having the opportunity to apply that in this industry has been a very rewarding career.
Now, Pete indicated that he visited a control tower when he was 11. Alex, what brought you to aerospace?
So I'm a little like Pam. I mean, I was always good at math and science. I also had inherent interest in transportation. So we used to live in downtown Philadelphia. When I was little, I used to sit on the step and watch the buses go by. I used to build a lot of model railroads, and my mom jokes that me and my brother were a good pair because I had more interest in just building it. I didn't really care about playing with it as much, but my brother liked to play with the train sets. So as I went through school, I kept the math and science interest. When I got to college, I had to pick a major. I didn't really want to do the theoretical part of math or physics. I liked building things, so I did mechanical engineering. And then when I went to grad school, a lot of the grad mechanical engineering courses were on the more theoretical side, so I went to do something more concrete again, and that led me to aerospace.
Great. Now, if you would, I'd like to ask each of you this question. In my era, of course, reaching the moon was the biggie. More recently, it's been things like CubeSat and New Space, Mars, NextGen. What do you consider to be the next big challenge when it comes to maintaining the safety and the access of airspace, national airspace, for air travel? Pamela?
For me, and I say this kind of, speaking as Pamela, probably not the FAA, because we probably have documents that say various things, but I think we need to prepare for aviation to play a role in regional and local transportation. Living in the Washington metropolitan area, your commute grows every year, and you see people commuting now an hour and a half, sometimes 2 hours to get to work. There's technology out there that will allow for aviation in some form to play a role in transportation, and I think we should be, kind of looking at those concepts and preparing for that to play a role.
And Pete, from your vantage point, what do you see as the next grand challenge when it comes to air traffic control and that infrastructure itself?
Two things, commercial space and integrating drones into the airspace. That's going to be, I think that is going to be the single most difficult platform that we've ever had to integrate into the airspace system, because the airspace system wasn't designed for it. It was designed specifically for people in airplanes. So we have to look at it in a whole different light, a whole different way, and it's moving very quickly, as a lot of technology does now, as Alex was saying.
And any of the people who are checking in with us today who get a drone for Christmas need to go online and register it beginning Monday.
Right.
Alex, when you look at your career in the future, what's going to keep you juiced up about air traffic management and navigation, et cetera, what do you see as the next grand challenge for your generation?
Well, besides the ones that Pam and Pete mentioned, I want to pull the thread actually a little bit more on commercial space, which Pete also mentioned. This is more of a gleam in someone's eye, but I saw an article that they're thinking about how you would establish a space traffic control system, and whether that would be the FAA or a new agency or whoever it would be. But I just thought that was really cool that we're finally getting enough access to space that we need to start thinking about congestion in space. And to me, that could bring in a whole new realm of people and merge the space nerds with the airplane nerds and hopefully generate some more interest and be really cool.
It does bring about a whole different thing. We were laughing the other day. They are using drones to track bears in my neighborhood in North Carolina. And I woke up, and there was a drone out in my yard. And it was because I had 9 bears in my yard. It was kind of a funny thing to see, though, in the morning. And that you don't really, most of us don't understand the line of sight rules and the new regulations. I think that there's going to be some new business opportunities that crop up with the things that you've talked about as well for entrepreneurs. Do any of you have any comments about that? I met a young man who was starting a business. He retired from the Marine Corps and was starting a business to help drone pilots understand airspace regulations. Do you have any thoughts on that as in terms of entrepreneurship and what your line of work is? Alex?
Sure. So I think that all this excitement and entrepreneurship is a good thing for the industry as a whole. It brings in a lot of new people and new ideas, and we have to figure out a way to sort of harness that energy, educate people about some of the problems that you mentioned that aren't as publicly known as just sort of the overall general UAV problem. But I think that all the entrepreneurship is a good thing, and that we should be able to get a whole new group of people interested, and that would bring in new investment, new ideas, new products that will help the airspace.
Pamela, you see it from a contractor vantage point. what are you kind of seeing, and what would you tell somebody who has a startup idea and wants to get in the door with you all?
So I think there's a lot of opportunity growing around applications. So I've talked a lot about data, putting data in an environment to turn it into information. So we have the responsibility on the FAA side to provide information needed for the controllers and for the day-to-day operation. But that data will also be available in a way that, you know, entrepreneurs or the companies can get that data and build value-added applications for industry. Many of you have gone online to actually see where your airplane is on the day that you travel. Well, that's data that they're getting from the FAA. Just imagine, you know, other elements of data, like some of the weather data, like some of the position data, and the possibility for applications that add value in different places, I think is just rich.
That sounds like a great opportunity. We always laugh about this within the advisory boards on our workforce study, and the new entries, you know, we hear about government agencies going and setting up outposts in Silicon Valley and trying to bring that energy to bear on aerospace. And it looks like we have a lot of energy from what you all are saying. But we also refer to Google, Apple, Facebook, and Amazon as GAFA. And that GAFA is kind of encroaching on our workforce and stealing some of our best and brightest. What do you think the industry or your agencies need to do make sure that we remain a really great place to work? Beyond the technical challenge, what is it that we need to do to be a great employer? Or what about your organization makes it a great employer? Pamela?
So I think the first thing is to continue to do things like this to get the word out about why it's exciting to work in aviation today. One of the things that, you know, we talk about with our workforce is we are changing a industry that has been consistent for many years. It's vital to our country, both from a transportation standpoint and an economic standpoint. So having an opportunity to work in that environment to make changes that are going to change this forever, I mean, you know, Pete talked about drones and, you know, space transportation. Those are things for the next generation. You know, we see them coming on board, but we don't know the potential for those things and what they will mean to people in the future. So having people understand that it is not just a job, it is an exciting opportunity at a point in our history to actually put this infrastructure in a place and put it in a state where people can build on it for generations to come. And I think if we can get those people that have a true interest in transportation, a true interest in, you know, great technology, even an interest in space transportation, get them a good understanding of what we're doing and the kinds of things that they can do and influence in the jobs in this industry, I think we'll be able to attract good people.
One of the data points that we gathered is that the aerospace industry, aviation industry, actually has some of the best benefits around in terms of ongoing learning. Alex, can you talk about that from your vantage point? Because I know that was important to you.
Yeah, a little bit. Well, I personally haven't taken advantage of that opportunity, but I know that a lot of my friends and coworkers have taken the chance to get a master's, get a PhD while they're here at Northrop. There's also other great benefits, like I think the work-life balance in general is pretty good. At least at Northrop, it's a very flexible place to work. I can work from home if I need to. I can move my hours around if I need to do something. So having the ability to work hard when you need to and also work things around your life is really valuable.
Great. Now, one of the other things that we have found is that people actually highly value getting to work next to the experts. the person who created the person. Can you talk a little bit about that? Because I think sometimes people think, oh, the master of the universe when it comes to next gen must be secreted away in a closet or whatever. When really, you are working elbow to elbow with the giants of the industry. Could you talk about that a little bit, Pamela?
So it's interesting you say that. I say that all the time. So we are creating aviation for the future, and I think in a large way, we're almost responsible for making sure we get that information back into the academic arena, because what they have is kind of yesterday's view of aviation, and we're creating tomorrow's view of aviation. But, you know, working at the FAA, we have, you know, researchers that really go unnoticed. They're kind of unsung heroes in terms of the work that they do. They influence safety regulations. They influence a lot of discussion that you hear going on today about unmanned aircraft systems. We have researchers that are looking at, you know, how should the system respond to a launch. So, you know, if a spacecraft is being launched, that impacts the aviation system because you have routes that are being impacted. We have researchers that are researching that today and even looking at models of what would happen if there were some unforeseen accident and there's debris. So these are individuals that kind of see this as their day-to-day job. They enjoy doing it, but they really are influencing what will be standard practice at some day in the future on how we respond to today's challenges.
That's great. We also have some data that indicates that, in fact, while GAFA, Google, Amazon, Facebook, and Google, Apple, Facebook, Amazon, while they are appealing, they don't have really the same kinds of opportunities that we do, and our compensation is, in fact, right in line with many of those companies from an industry standpoint. So I think that that's a good one. Pete, from your vantage point on the air traffic control piece, what would you say makes air traffic control an attractive employer? So not just the technology, but the attraction of, I'm going to have a life if I go to work there. We only hear the nightmares about...
Right. You know, the thing that struck me is Alex said a work-life balance, which is, that's one thing you won't have as an air traffic controller, because you work shift work. You know, you see a lot of lot on the news about people having to work Black Friday. Well, air traffic controllers work every holiday, and they do three shifts every single day. But again, it's the I think it's the instant gratification. I think it's the aviation piece. You know, once it bites you, aerospace and aviation, you can't get away from it. It's infectious, and it just becomes part of your life, and you end up loving it. Whether you're right in the middle of it, in the thick of it, or whether you're on the periphery, everybody that I know that works in this industry loves working in this industry. They're very proud to say they're part of aviation.
Well, that's a good way to end this. Just to reiterate, not only that, but we have, as an industry, the lowest attrition rate of any industry in the United States. So people do come to work here and do like to stay. I hope you will join me in thanking our panelists for their time and their thoughts today. We take for granted that airplanes go where they are supposed to go and that pilots are aware of what surrounds them in the sky. And I think you all have shared with us that there's a lot more to it than what is presumed. The people on the ground and in the air, the people who come with new ideas and new thoughts, as well as those who have been around for decades. I'd like to also thank everyone who joined our Hangout today for participating. And while the Hangout is closing, the conversation needs to keep going. Stay in touch with us, #NextGenWorkforce. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.